Hello and welcome to Real Metal. I am your host, Mark. I'd like to introduce my panel. Joining us once again, we have JP.
Hello.
Ben. And James. Well, this time around, we're taking a look at the 1998 film Strangeland. JP, have you seen this one before?
Yes, I found it in the bargain bin at one of the big box retailers about 10 years ago. So I've seen it, but just the once.
Ben?
No, never heard of it until today.
James, you're a big fan of this film.
Yeah, when I was a kid, when I was growing up, this movie was fucking... I just loved it.
All right, let's take a look at the trailer.
Here we go.
In this small town...
Check this guy out.
On this quiet street...
Now we can talk to him one-on-one.
An unspeakable evil is stalking the net.
What kind of name is Captain Howdy?
He found a series of symmetrically placed puncture wounds.
Teased Orchard.
Welcome to my world, Detective.
Pain is a uniquely personal experience.
Oh, God, please don't let this be happening.
My badges are forever.
My badge represents the law.
I'll kill him.
Trust me.
That's better.
There's nowhere to run.
Daddy!
There's no place to hide.
Find me.
He's got this town wired.
Gotta love this technology.
Kevin Gage.
Ready to come in?
Elizabeth Peña.
What have you done with my daughter?
Robert Englund.
Somebody's gotta take that boy out.
Dee Snider.
So much flesh, so little time.
The hunt has begun.
Wanna play ball, Scarecrow?
Strangeland.
Now we're gonna get Ben to try and synopsize this film for us. Give it a go.
The chick from Freaks and Geeks, Linda Cardellini, she gets kidnapped by a body piercer, the alternative culture guy, called Captain Howdy, who she meets on a chat room. And her dad is a detective, I think. And yeah, it's just kind of a cat and mouse thing, right? Like him trying to catch him and then... And then finding out, and then the kind of marvel of the internet in the new age, and find the killer, and then he finds the killer. And am I going further than that without giving it away? I don't know.
I don't know.
Spoiler alert, it is like fucking 20 years old.
Just about, yeah. It's
yeah.
And there's supposed to be a sequel happening. They've been talking about that forever, but it looks like maybe it's going to happen now. So,
it's just kind of, it's a weird movie, like it's, yeah.
It's a very 90s movie, that's for sure.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, tons of references, to, like timely references.
New metal, butt munch.
Butt munch, pages, not understanding new technology.
Yeah.
They when they plug the laptop into the cell phone.
The cell phone with a big, like, what's it called, like an antenna? I don't know. Getting
voice messages over the, not having to wait for download or anything like that. Yeah.
And piercing and tattoos were apparently a big subculture.
According to that one mechanic, or the tow truck driver.
Yeah.
Body art, tattooing, piercing, branding, scarification. These are all forms of personal expression dating back to the fucking... caveman.
Yeah, he just happens to be there.
Yeah.
Like, what is this? And he's like, that looks like a septum piercing. It's her, and he's got a fucking huge one sitting on his face. I suppose we should have saw that coming, because he was the one blasting new metal out of his truck in a crime scene.
Kid Rock. He was playing Kid Rock out of his truck.
Yeah. Like, while they're trying to pull a car out of a lake, and they actually turn around and go, can you turn that down?
So this is written by Dee Snider from Twisted Sister. He's one and only writing credit in films. He's acted in a bunch of things, but and slightly based on the several Twisted Sister songs, I guess, from Stay Hungry.
Hmm. And Silence of the Lambs.
And Silence of the Lambs.
He clearly,
Nightmare on Elm Street.
Yeah, he'd seen these movies and has gone, hey, I can write this with lyrics from our songs and alternative culture.
Yeah, when did Stay Hungry come out? 84?
84.
84, so... And Nightmare came out in 84 as well, right?
Well, you reckon he wrote this in the 80s, and then, like, Clint Eastwood The Unforgiven, he waited 14 years.
Well, the story in the album is similar to this, the guy gets off on a technicality and then angry parents go after him.
Yeah, I think the germ of the idea was there from those songs, and they're sort of black sheep songs on the album. The rest of them are the big hits, of course.
Yeah.
I Wanna Rock and We're Not Taking Anymore. And then on the back end of the album, there's this three songs kind of strung together, 8 or 9 minutes, and it tells this story about vigilante justice and the pedophile, the murderer, and all this. And that germ stayed and kind of spun off into the film.
Yeah. Well, that's what I was thinking. I was like, all right, maybe he ripped off Nightmare with that whole vigilante justice thing and the killer coming back. But then it all came out around the same time, so...
Kind of. I mean, I didn't...
It's a pretty classic horror movie plot.
True.
Revenge.
Yeah, this movie was kind of chock full of cliches, which is fine in low budget because that does happen. The only times I thought it referenced Elm Street was probably when he was doing it on purpose.
Yeah.
You know, like, oh, what a rush.
Yeah, well, and Robert Englund was in the movie too, so...
Yeah, they got him for 2 days of filming.
Yeah.
Do you think that if Englund wasn't in that role, that the connection to Nightmare on Elm Street would be as strong? Maybe not.
No.
If it's just some schmuck that they hired to play the drunk mob leader. Mm-hmm.
We wouldn't be saying it like we are now.
Yeah. Well, I'm assuming Dee Snider's a...
probably a fan.
Yeah, a big horror movie fan, I'm guessing. Mm-hmm. Well, he wrote a horror film and put himself in the main role.
The film had kind of a weird, like, linear story, right? Like, it starts off, like, right away from the girls in the chat room, so it is giving that kind of pretext of, it's girls in the chat room and not knowing who you're talking to. But it quickly just really jumps into it, like, they get kidnapped, and then...
Not a lot of character development.
None.
Didn't really feel sorry, well... Yeah, on a human level, you feel sorry for the victims getting kidnapped and tortured, but it's like there's no empathy. It's like just some dumb teen. It's like, oh, I'm going to go on a date with some guy I met online tonight. Okay, well, I'm going to go to his house now. It's like, oh, really?
Her one friend tried to stop him for, like, you know, a couple
seconds.
Minutes.
Yeah.
A couple
Are you sure
minutes,
this is a good idea? Yeah, okay, let's go.
That was a huge worry back in the day, though. With, you know, that was brand new technology.
Yeah.
Like, we were talking about with ICQ and,
AOL,
MSN
Messenger, and stuff like that. Well, that was all really new in 1998.
People pretending to be someone they're not.
Yeah.
Well, we definitely didn't. It was around in 98, but we in England and Europe, I don't think we had it until a couple of years later. Or where households had it, should I say.
Yeah.
Things like that.
I know we had the internet at that point. I was downloading music, you know, you get a song in about 4 or 5 hours. It was incredible. There are some leaps in this where he sends a voice message like immediately through the computer.
You say that there are those inherent worries that were around at that time, but did this movie do anything to address that in a positive way at all?
Well, I think they were just playing on that,
I guess.
Yeah, it was just...
they said if you do this, you're going to get killed.
You're going to get kidnapped by freaky, half-tattooed, red-haired, pierced guys who listen to bad metal.
Can we talk about Captain Howdy for a little bit?
Sure.
Yeah, we haven't got to that.
He's quite the character.
I thought he was creepier when he was rehabilitated and wearing
a
cardigan.
Well, that was...
He was like
the white makeup, like, really pasty. There's the thing about Dee Snider, is we all know Dee Snider is very well spoken.
Mm-hmm.
We all saw that in his court clippings and whatnot, and so he carries that really well. Like, they could have had a really dumb actor do it, and it wouldn't have come off as well. He's so well spoken that he actually comes across as a half decent actor.
Yeah, agreed. Yeah, he carried the film. You almost were rooting for him, the bad guy.
Well, he's always been a very charismatic guy anyway, so, like, you know, as soon as you point the camera at him, he's on.
Mm-hmm.
Either he's acting over the top crazy, but I even like the way he acted as the kind of nebbish little dude. Like, he even looks smaller, right?
Carlton
he's ripped
Hendricks?
In this movie.
Yeah.
Like, he's ripped in this fucking movie.
He's
he really looks great.
Big,
And then when you show him as, like, when he's all rehabilitated, he
looks
small.
Pathetic.
He comes off as meek, right?
Yeah,
like, he's great like that.
Yeah.
In fact, we talked about, like, trivia with it. He did say that Dee Snider said during filming that actually the cardigan scenes were the worst, hardest scenes for him.
Yeah.
Because he hates wearing cardigans.
Had to rein it in.
I tell you, cardigans are comfortable.
I do like, for their benefit, I gotta say it was good that they didn't show him straight away.
Mm, agreed.
They did build that up. You got to see all these silhouette shots of him, which gave you a good idea of what he was going to end up looking like. He kind of ended up, like we were saying, he ended up looking like kind of a cross between the prankster from Brain Scan, a bit like Wes from Mad Max 2 Road Warrior.
Yeah. And Red Dragon.
Yeah, yeah, with the tattoo work. Yeah. The Tooth Fairy.
Yeah.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, like, I'm kind of wondering how this got made in 1998, because Twisted Sister wasn't really on anyone's radar back then.
That's true.
Maybe that's how it got made, though.
Yeah.
He had that time. He knew he could get the backing for it. Someone liked the script.
Yeah. Well, that's what I was wondering, how he got the backing, and, you know, to be the writer and then star in this movie. It's not like, you know, he was a huge name in 1998.
And almost 20 years ago, it wasn't like today where people can do movies, quality movies, on their laptop.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
In their home.
Mm-hmm. No.
Needed a crew.
Yeah.
It took a production crew and everything.
Yeah. Like, it was obviously, I don't know what the budget was, but it wasn't very big.
No, they didn't have a lot of money. But I'll tell you what, they really, some of the set pieces in it were well above your average indie filmmaking.
Yeah.
The scenes in the club, the scene with the fire, things like that, that's mm-hmm. well above what the average indie filmmaker can get away with in 1998.
Yeah, well, as far as I know, it's got a pretty big release. I remember being in theaters and the advertising board. Really? Yeah. We were all super stoked to see it. Yeah, it was a bunch of metalheads and Dee Snider's in the fucking movie. Yeah, great. So we got to see this. And it's a horror movie.
And it had some other up and comers in it, like Linda Cardellini, Amy Smart.
Yeah, I didn't even realize that was Linda Cardellini. Like, I saw her name come up in the credits at first. And didn't even realize that was her at first.
It took me a while.
Yeah.
Because I recognized her and I was like, who is that?
Yeah.
And it also had the black detective who's in everything. I could have sworn he'd done like a long stint on Law and Order. I looked it up. No. But he's got like 180 odd credits to his name of TV shows.
Sergeant this, lieutenant that.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, he's done them all, right?
Like, I mean, Captain Howdy's an odd name. Like, I get the reference that comes from Exorcist, right? But I don't know how many.
He doesn't look like a ghoul. That's the thing. So it's the username.
Yeah.
The MSN username.
Right? Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
It's kind of what it is.
That makes sense in the movie because like it was like, all right, you'd pick a name that you thought was cool or whatever, like you'd a thing that you were into. But he also used it in 1984 in The Elf.
In The Elf.
So clearly he's a fan.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, we all know Exorcist and. That kind of the thing with Captain Howdy is quite shocking, and it has that scene where she goes that on the screen.
Yeah,
and you kind of get that one shot.
Yeah,
you never forget that shot, right? So you know everyone knows if you know Exorcist, you know Captain Howdy is.
Yeah, it's. I don't know. I enjoyed the film. I thought it was. It does have a lot of
holes.
Or
yeah.
It feels like the second half of a movie. It just because it comes in. I got to be honest with you guys right now. When he got to the house where Captain Howdy was keeping the victims the first time, before he was captured, and he went up and was like, oh, baby, let me get you out of there. I didn't know that was his daughter. I thought Amy Smart was his daughter.
You thought the one that was they found in the car was his daughter, or...
No, I thought Amy Smart was his daughter because she was always there.
Yeah, like, he didn't even really establish it off the bat when she goes missing and he's at the computer...
She calls her Uncle Rob or something, like Uncle or something.
Really?
Yeah, no, yeah, she does do that, but it goes by so quick that you don't, like even JP mentions, like there's character building's not really there, so you don't get attached to these people.
No,
you can barely realize what relationships they have.
Mm-hmm. The detective and his wife, right?
Yeah.
Honestly, I could just forget that they were a couple.
Yeah.
I was kind of hoping that the wife would go after Captain Howdy.
Mm-hmm.
The first time I saw it, and it was reinforced this time. It's like she was really mad that he was molesting her daughter, and then the angry mom revenge subplot could have been quite nice if she was the one who went after him.
Yeah.
Did anybody else find it weird that like how they were taking the fact that their child was kidnapped or missing?
Pretty calm.
Yeah, they were very calm about it.
But it was almost like from the moment that it cuts from the opening scene where he's at the computer and everything, it's very poorly established that, okay, he's detective man, he's taking over, yada, yada, yada. It's just like, oh, well, detectives will take care of it.
Yeah.
There's the vigilante part later when he's released, but it really is kind of just assumed, oh, detectives will take care of it. And his partner was just awful. That guy's acting was
he had that
like
one
Eric Roberts bad. Man, I loved it. Like,
He had that one great line. I can't remember it, though.
So I'm laughing.
That's how great it was.
I'm trying to remember
mega-biting ass.
Oh. Come down there and arrest your mega-biting ass.
That was awesome.
For a horror film, it had a decent amount of, not explicit gore, but there was the piercing scenes.
Yeah.
It could be uncomfortable for people who weren't, you know, when... Yeah, he gets his nose ring ripped out and
yeah.
a few things like that. It's like, well, yeah, I cringed a little bit.
And there was the thing about the piercing of the dick.
Yeah.
Which was yeah. very comical.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's almost pre-torture porn, right? The,
yeah.
the precursor to things that like Saw and everything that just came along and just...
It
was, like,
didn't quite show everything. There was a bit of blood, bit of nudity, but not explicit.
It's almost tasteful.
Yeah, horror was in a strange place back in... '98.
Well, out of the mainstream, was
yeah.
not taking revenue anymore.
No.
I wonder if movies like this one and 8mm kind of brought that kind of bondage scene to the mainstream.
Possibly.
There was I can't think of another movie in that era that was like that.
Yeah.
That, yeah, 8mm was one that came around a few years
yeah.
later, right?
And yeah, I think that was later, yeah.
And that was a few, and that, yeah, that was the Nicolas Cage one with Joaquin
yeah.
Phoenix, and it's, that film was really grotesque.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's a really
yeah.
seedy movie.
I mean, at the time, like, what was big, the Scream series was big. There was a lot of those teen horror movies
yeah,
that were...
What You Did Last Summer.
Yeah, that type of stuff that was happening.
Light, yeah.
And this was a lot different than
any
of
those. Well, lots of really poppy stuff, like tons of fluff movies.
Yeah.
Yeah.
In the 90s. Were
just like, this did feel like a 90s movie, don't get me wrong. It's fucking really 90s.
Well, we were joking that
we even watched it in 4x3, so...
We were joking that it was clearly made after Scream and that.
Yeah.
You could see this being on the shelf and being easily mistaken for something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Given that someone like Amy Smart was in it.
Yeah.
She did a lot of B-movies in the mid to late 90s, including action movies, before she got a break.
Yeah.
And you could see people picking this up, thinking it's along those lines.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I got to say, though, we were talking about Dee Snider's look as Captain Howdy. It must have taken a lot to put all those prosthetics on.
Yeah.
He had a hell of a lot going on
mm-hmm.
With the piercings. And it did seem to change as well. It wasn't always the same.
Yeah,
I think.
That might have just been an error.
Continuity.
wasn't that on the... Your hump on the left side?
I'll look more hardcore if you better hear it out.
But his look was really impressive. He went for a lot of effort. That red hair... That's not something that can just be done. That's
yeah.
effort.
Yeah. Yeah, and yeah, his look was pretty great. And
mm-hmm.
they really played up that whole tattoo piercing thing. Like, it's hard to remember, like, because it's almost 20 years ago, that was shocking to see, I guess. You still see someone with a tattoo on their face, I think it's still kind of shocking, but...
To a large portion of the population, it is.
Yeah.
Still.
Yeah.
Still. Now, there wasn't many movies doing it. I do remember in Michael Bay's Bad Boys, the one with Will Smith and Mark Lawrence, they do go to a nightclub in it.
Yeah.
That is a very, very soft version of what we saw. And I do remember just a kind of loud, almost late 90s goth techno music and that kind of... That's as close as it would have got for mainstream.
Well, Blade kind of had a scene like that. Blade,
mm.
was it Blade 3
yeah.
or Blade 2?
Blade 1 in the basement.
Was
in the basement
one,
with
yeah.
blood.
Mm-hmm.
Well, let's talk about the music then for a minute. This
is awesome.
Right, good soundtrack.
Solid.
Had a
very
lot of fun
yeah.
with that soundtrack.
I mean, there was a lot of metal on there, that's for sure. Like Megadeth, Anthrax.
Soulfly.
There was a Pantera song that I sort of missed when we were watching it, but it's on the soundtrack.
Didn't hear that. Didn't hear a Cold Chamber track. But
yeah.
it could have been, I didn't know it though.
Yeah.
Head
P, we think, was that song.
Yeah. Marilyn
sure.
Manson.
Yeah.
We mentioned already.
And bookending the soundtrack was the Dee Snider solo song.
Yeah.
And then that new Twisted Sister song and the exit credits,
yeah.
Heroes Are Hard to Find, which was like the first thing they'd recorded in a decade.
Yeah.
As a band. So a little rarity. For the Twisted Sister fans, one song.
Yeah.
I haven't been afraid of anything in my whole life. Do you know why? Because I wish I was dead.
My favorite reaction shot, though, was where the guy is tied up early in the film, and he's talking to him about how he's going to pierce his penis.
Yeah.
And he just shows him one of them, and just the guy's reaction was just...
his mouth is sewn shut, just...
It's like, yeah, perfect.
well chosen.
Well chosen.
That was the proper reaction.
Absolutely.
That's exactly.
You said that. You're like, absolutely perfect reaction, because I think we all kind of went, what is that? Oh, shit.
There was a pretty, that dream sequence was pretty scary, you know. I remember as a kid, I always thought that was a pretty scary dream sequence when he meets her. Yeah, when he grabs her up to chase her up the stairs and stuff.
And I felt empathy for her when she woke up screaming, calling for her daddy.
That was about the only character building.
Linda Cardellini is a pretty decent actress, though. Like, yeah. Freaks and Geeks was a really good show. Yeah. Like, for the one season it ran for, she kind of led that whole show. The only thing that was funny about that scene is that it used that multi-cut edit because it can't show anything, and because they clearly had agreed with her, all they could keep showing was her bra.
It was like there was a shirt on, it was off, shirt on, it was off. It was like the
strap.
I guess to wrap things up, JP, would you recommend it?
I think so. Yeah, it was fun. I mean, I liked it enough to buy it. I didn't spend a lot of money on it. Like I said, bargain bin special, but it was an enjoyable horror flick. I'm kind of glad we watched it again. I might put it back into rotation, you know.
Ben?
I'd recommend this one to a few.
Qualified, like me, kind of qualified.
I'll tell you what, I'm probably going to end up owning this. I enjoyed it enough. Like I said, it reminded me of things like Brain Scan, we will probably talk about one day on the show. And I love that movie. It's a great movie, and it's not a great movie at all. I've shown it to so many people, and they're like, this is shit. I think I could recommend this to a few of my friends, and they would be like, yeah, it was all right. It was pretty cool.
I enjoyed this one when I was growing up, and I didn't enjoy it as much this time around, but I still, you know, I'd recommend it. It's a fun movie.
Yeah, I enjoyed it as well. It's a long time. I don't think I've seen it since it was actually released on VHS or back in the day, but and it was nostalgic because we got to watch it in that sort of
those things are fun to laugh at, aren't they? Those kind of timely things.
Yeah.
Butt Munch, I think, was great.
Yeah.
And I just got to say, my favorite line from it was, "The dead are dreadfully dead when they're dead."
Yeah.
Oh my god. That has stuck with me.
Like, Mr. Snyder, quick rewrite, maybe. I don't know. Just
you know, they thought they were so clever when they came up with that.
Okay, before we go, plugs.
Plugs. Well, don't forget to check out metalrules.com, where we review a lot of movies on the site as well.
Listen to Trier, Calgary Black Metal, and drink Wild Rose. Calgary beer.
Listen to Gales of Avalon, and check out Night Terrors Film Society.
Watch Gales of Avalon's new lyric video. I spent many hours making it, and no one looked at it. Alright, that's going to do it for another episode of Real Metal. Thanks so much, guys, for joining us once again. If you enjoyed this episode, please hit that like and share button, and leave a comment if there's a movie you'd like to see us do in the future, because we're always down for suggestions.
Sweet.
And until next time... kick your megabyte nuts.
Come down there. Then arrest your megabyte nuts.
Hey, Steve.